Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. We're here on the Gray Spot. So, you know you're late when your mom texts you and calls you and asks you, where's Charnay by Grace? I'm like, okay, let me get it moving because clearly Charnay by Grace needs to get on with it this morning. Merry Christmas Eve. We made it. Oh my God, it is Christmas Eve, right? Yeah. December 24th. It has been a very long year and we have all been praying to just make it to this point. So to God be the glory that we are here on Christmas Eve and I am feeling my most centric self. I got me a retooled hair bow and my oldest daughter made me this. So I promised I would display her work on the Gray Spot this morning. And so I'm just delighted to be here today. I cannot wait to have today's watch party with those who will watch again and with those who were not able to watch the first time, because I'm just excited about Christmas. Christmas is one of my favorite times of the year. I would have to say my favorite season is the fall. I just love the tapestry and the color changes of the fall. But Christmas just does something for me, mostly because my mother made Christmas so amazing. And I would use the word magic, but I think it's something different than that. I think it's more like imagination. And that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit today is imagination. Remember when we could visualize things and we could see them in our head. And then one day someone told us to be realistic and we stopped imagining things. Well, those are some things that we should never put behind us as adults. You should never stop imagining your future, your opportunities, what God is doing, Santa. Believe how you want to believe, because God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above what we could ever imagine or think. And so because of that, because God is able, He has given us the will and the insight to imagine those things that He has put inside of us, those things that we wanted to become as children, those ideas we had in our head or those inventions we created. I see so many young, talented mothers on my timeline, my younger cousins, girlfriends and wives, and how they are pulling these children together and they're starting their clothing lines and they're getting them in pageants and they just trust God. They just believe that what God has given them is the best present they could ever get in their children. And I'm so proud to be a part of that legacy. I want them to know that I see them and I hear them. I see you and I hear you. It is so good when you can take your imagination and make it a reality. And how is anything ever built without imagination? I know for me, growing up, we were taught Santa is a spirit. Well, I get that. Santa's a spirit, okay. So he moves and he ebbs and he flows, because I understood the power of the Holy Spirit. I understood as a small child that the Spirit was unseen, that the Spirit was in my heart. And so that made sense to me. You know, the fact that I couldn't see him and I couldn't track him and I couldn't trace him. That was a part of my experience of faith. Santa was a part of my experience of faith. Now, I understand, you know, we're always trying to put Santa Claus in perspective, and you just do what you feel like you have to do for you and yours. But my thing is, as long as I have an imagination, I'm probably going to believe in Santa at some part, even though I know I'm a major part of making sure that we put together something incredible for our children every year on Christmas Day. I also realized that when I wake up with them and I see it too, I still believe, I still have faith that the spirit of Santa will be embodied in my home. And that's essentially what we're talking about in this season of giving and believing God. So all week we have been talking about the plan of salvation. And so today we're going to be talking about believing, because accepting wholeness, which is the plan of salvation, involves believing. It involves taking your trust to the next level and believing only. And even in the face of unbelief, still believing, which sounds weird and an oxymoron, but it's an infinite concept that in our finite minds we don't understand. Yet it happens. Yet we believe and we have unbelief accompanying us at the same time. So such is the miracles of Christ in this season. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Almighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. So believing is not always seeing. Believing is something that is to come, just like the baby Jesus and how he developed into a man and he walked the earth for 33 years and he only had about 3 active years of ministry. So I just get excited when I think about the plan of salvation and accepting wholeness. And in accepting my wholeness, in accepting Christ, I accept belief. So it's all about believing. So before I sing today, I wanted to give you these funny memes that I found about Santa. Why we should let the kids believe in Santa. Okay, listen, you don't have to do it. It's just for fun, okay? So one of them says, please allow children to believe in Santa Claus. You believe in essential oils and no one is ruining it for you. No one is ruining it for you. You believe in essential oils? Ashe, do you? Let's see. This one is kind of cruel, so let me just give you a disclaimer. Let the kids believe in Santa. Some of y'all still believe your man's gonna change. That was wrong, but you know, he can grow. He might not change, but you know, he can grow. Let's see. They had at least one more I wanted to read. Oh Lord. No, okay, this is my last one. This is my favorite one. Let your kids believe in Santa. You believe you look like your filtered picture. I do. I believe I look like my filtered picture. I love filters. People can't forget it. I'm always going to put filters on my picture. I like to take them raw sometimes, but why? When you can have a filter. Anyway, Snapchat for life. Okay, so plan of salvation, accepting wholeness, and believing. Okay, this is going to be like an enchilada lesson. So I hope you can eat of it and digest it and just enjoy your Christmas Eve. I know a lot of you all still have things that you need to do. And so we're going to help you get on with your day. Listen, oh Lord. Okay, that's me scooping up, y'all. Forgive me. I have practiced this song and I'm just going to have to go with God. Oh Lord. I tell you, boy, I got to get a better tech crew. My tech crew be off some days. Okay, there we go. Let's see. I think that's okay. Yeah. Okay. All right, y'all. Remember, no judgments. No judgment zone. I give it my personal best and you love me. All right.
Someday at Christmas, men won't be boys, playing with bombs like kids play with toys. One warm December, our hearts will see a world where men are free. Someday at Christmas, there'll be no wars, when we have learned what Christmas is for. When we have found what life's really worth, there'll be peace on earth. Someday all our dreams will come to be. Someday in a world where men are free. Maybe not in time for you and me, but someday at Christmas time. Someday at Christmas we'll see a land, no hungry children, no empty hands. One happy morning people will share a world where people care. Someday at Christmas there'll be no tears, all men are equal and no men have fears. One shining moment, one prayer away from our world today. Someday at Christmas, dreams will come true. Someday in a world where men will be free. Maybe not in time for you and me, But someday at Christmas time, someday at Christmas, man will not fail. Hate will be gone and love will prevail. Someday a new world that we can start with hope in every heart. Oh, someday at Christmas. Yeah, 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 yeah. Maybe not in time for you and me, but someday at Christmas time. Someday at Christmas time.
Oh, Stevie's so sweet. You just got to do your best for Stevie, okay? Oh, that made me feel so warm inside. So let's imagine some things together today. I want to begin with Mark the 11th chapter and the 24th verse. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that someday at Christmas, we can imagine a world where things are better, where children are not hungry, where there are no wars, where there is peace and there is love and kindness, God. And we know that this kindness just does not come by osmosis or it's infamous from the world. We know that this is something that we're looking for from you, God. And in this moment, as we talk about believing, just allow our spirits to be open to whatever you have for us. Speak through my vocal cords and think through my mind. None of me and all of you. And we'll be careful to honor you in this day of believing on Christmas Eve. We love you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed that because I give it to you in the best spirit today. That someday at Christmas time, not only will we see things that we don't see now, but we can also trust that God is going to utilize us and that one day our best Christmas present will be being used by God, being called by God, and living out our calling on purpose every day. So, Mark 11:24, again, it says, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Why? Why should we believe? Why should we believe that the things we pray for we're going to get? We've prayed for some things in the past and we haven't necessarily gotten everything that we wanted. But here's the thing, there's such a thing called desires of the heart. Desires are placed there in various means. Desires come through the eye gate and the ear gate, and sometimes they make their way out of the mouth gate, right? However, there's another side of believing. There's another side of desires. Desires that come from God, generally speaking, come to fruition. And it's not even a general speech. It's the truth that they do come true. They don't always come true in the way that we expect them or want them. And that's where our faith gets shaky, because we ask God for something and we expect it to come through a certain way. But the truth of the matter is God never promised that. He never promised that. He promised that he would deliver the desires of our heart. He didn't say that it would be, you know, a man that's 6'4 and chocolate and that he'd have a bow on him and be standing in front of my door. No, 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 no. When you're believing God for a mate, you're believing God for children, you're believing God for your calling or to walk out your purpose every day, feeding the hungry. Maybe you're trying to clothe the naked, meet with the sick, or you're trying to help those that are in jail. Maybe you work in corporate America and you want to see business prosper for the people at the bottom. Those are desires that God has placed in your heart. Now, listen, you can't tell God to give you something and give you all the details and put all the details that you want in it just like you want it. Because we have been created by God. And in God's being God's creation, what we have to remember is that there are certain things that fit with the creation. And I often use the analogy of a puzzle piece. When you think about a puzzle piece, you think that, okay, this is a puzzle and it has to fit with another puzzle piece. when you put three puzzle pieces together and you fit that next one, that first one, and the colors match and you know that this is a part of the picture, it's very powerful. It's regal. It's like, okay, I can imagine what the rest of this picture looks like. I'm looking at the box, and now that I've put these two pieces together, I can see. But then you got that third piece, and it looks like it fits, and it does fit. It actually goes in exactly where it needs to go, but the colors don't match, and it doesn't make any sense why the piece would fit, but the colors don't match. And that's kind of how our thinking is when we give our desires to God and we believe against unbelief that something is supposed to happen. We want it to fit in with the colors, and sometimes it's just not that piece. It may be the same cut, but it does not match the tapestry. And such is the kingdom of God. Now, that third piece goes somewhere. It just may not be attached to those two. Likewise, somebody may get that piece just that way, but it's going to be attached to them and not you. Also, let's just say you push that piece in there. You believe God against all unbelief. You let your imagination have its way and you say, I want it exactly like this, Jesus. You push it in and you keep putting your puzzle together of life. There are other pieces that fit on the side of that puzzle, but none of them make sense with the first two. So then we try to make a square place fit this triangle. We try to make something fit that doesn't belong. And that's when we start to lose faith, because we realize and we recognize that I'm not going to get it the way I asked it. And so as we grow in faith and as we grow as believers, we begin to see how God can work. We begin to see how, as we understand the tapestry that is our life, that there are just certain pieces that God has to put in place the way God wants to put those things in place. Because the word says that all things work together for the good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. But if it does not fit, it does not fit. And so we have to grapple with that as believers and as people. Even non-believers have to understand the reality that if something doesn't fit, it just doesn't fit. And oftentimes we become insane or crazed and we get really emotional and infatuated with things because we just need it to fit. And the resignation of understanding that everything won't fit is everything we need in life. As soon as we get untangled from the thing that we feel like must fit, that's when God can give us exactly what fits, exactly what makes sense. So that is an idea of belief that it takes some time to understand. We didn't really get it as kids, but as kids, we had less expectation, right? We didn't say, oh, we want this coloring book. We said we wanted to color. So a coloring book was provided for us. What do you want for Christmas? I'd like some new tennis shoes and a truck. They didn't say it had to be by Hasbro or that it had to be Jordans. You got new tennis shoes and a truck. Likewise, when we believe God, we should believe God as little children because we are his children. So I'm going to delve deep into a passage today, Mark the 9th chapter. This was a very interesting time in the ministry of Christ. Jesus had began to tighten his space up, right? He had began to only do certain things with three disciples. That was James, Peter, and John. And he took them for very specific reasons. He didn't let all the disciples be exactly in his inner circle. Surely the 12 disciples were in his inner circle. However, there was this core, right? And many of us have a core like Jesus. We have those three people we know we can call on, we can depend on, we can believe God for if we need anything in life. And then sometimes even those three people have some stuff going on and they can't be there in the way that we want them to be on that day and at that time. So in Mark the 9th chapter, it says, and he said to them, assuredly, I say to you that there are some standing here who will not taste death till they see the kingdom of God present with power. The second verse. Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, and led them up on a mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured there, meaning his figure changed. It was transformed. And it transformed and transfigured right before them. His clothes became shining, exceedingly white, like snow, such as no launderer on earth can whiten them. And Elijah appeared to them with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. So you get this moment where Peter and James and John are with Christ, and Christ becomes transfigured and transformed. He becomes white and whiter than any white we can imagine. And here come Elijah appearing with Moses, and they're talking with Jesus. And the three disciples are looking like, okay, we don't know what's happening, but just go with it. So there's a lot happening here. And it says, then Peter answered and said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. And let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," because he did not know what to say, for they were greatly afraid. And that's what happens when we get afraid, right? We start doing random stuff. And a cloud came and overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved son, hear him." Suddenly, when they had looked around, they saw no one anymore, but only Jesus with themselves. Now, as they came down from the mountain, he commanded them they should tell no one the things that they had seen, till the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept his word. They kept this word to themselves, questioning what the rising from the dead meant. And they asked him, saying, "Why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first?" Then he answered and told them, "Indeed, Elijah is coming first and restores all things. And how is it written concerning the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be treated with contempt? But I say to you that Elijah has also come, and they did to him whatever they wished, as it is written of him." So they come down from the mountain. Jesus is back with the other disciples. Verse 14, and when he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them. And the scribes, those scribes we were just talking about, and scribes disputing with them, the disciples. Immediately when they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed and running to him, greeted him. And he asked the scribes, "What are you discussing with them?" Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son, who has a mute spirit, and wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not." He answered him and said, "Oh, faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." Then they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But you can do anything. Have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "Deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more." Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, and came out of him. And he became as one that was dead. So that many said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" So he said to them, "This kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting." So this entire piece in Mark 9 is a direct understanding, a direct indication of belief, right? You get Jesus going away, having this encounter with Elijah and Moses, and you have this meaningful experience. The disciples are trying to figure out what's happening, and they start asking him questions based on what the scribes say. And the scribes were religious leaders. And then God speaks directly and says, listen, you need to just listen to what he's saying. Jesus is the Son of God, and he's telling you exactly what you need to do. So then they go back into their normal context, right? Acting natural. But as soon as Jesus gets on the scene, people see him, right? And they're amazed immediately by seeing him. So then you get this interaction, and what's happening behind the scenes is this discussion with the scribes and the disciples about, you know, really, we just believe this stuff is from Satan. So, you know, all this casting out. And look at you, disciples, you couldn't even do it. So Jesus has been transfigured, transformed. Elijah and Moses appear. Now the three are afraid. Peter starts talking about erecting monuments. He has no idea what to say. And when many of us are afraid, we start doing and saying things to compensate for what we don't understand. Then we fast forward past them, asking questions about the occurrence. Scribes or religious men who lacked boldness are disputing with the disciples, who are unable to cast out the spirit. The scribes thought casting out demons was the devil's work. However, when the scribes wouldn't do it, the disciples couldn't do it, Jesus did it. The concerned father said, I believe, but help my unbelief. I always thought this meant give me the faith I lack, right? So I have faith, but it's incomplete. Now, we know that that's not true. We know that God has given each of us the portion that is necessary in our faith. We know that all we need is faith the size of a mustard seed, so we don't need more faith. So what is this saying? So if it's not lack, what is it? I thought that I needed to get more faith because I lack, so I can believe a thing and it will be done. I now understand what the scripture meant, and what the Father meant by help was from the Greek root boethio, and it means to bring aid or comfort. Not help like fill in the gaps, but Lord, bring me comfort by ending this torment and therefore removing the unbelief. So clearly he believed, right? Because in the end, he was able to get his son to the disciples. He had heard of the good works and he knew, and he was a smart man, but it wasn't happening. So it's not that there was the absence of belief, but there was also this presence of unbelief. And there's this coexisting. There's this dichotomy within this man, because he knows what he sees in this, in his son. He has put him in the flame and the water to cast the spirit out, yet the spirit is still in there. Then the disciples come and they lay hands on him and they do their disciple thing. And then suddenly they're unable to do it, right? Then you got religious men taunting them, saying, see, I told you, you're out here telling people what you can do, and where's your Jesus? Okay. So then, of course, Jesus makes the crooked way straight and he gets it done. But in the end, it's not the lack, it's the comfort. So when we think about unbelief, we think about lack or weakness instead of strength. But God's word says his strength is made perfect in our weakness. So even in our unbelief, we're made strong in him. It's just a different way of thinking about it, because we need to seek comfort from God. We seek comfort in the world and people. And we wonder why people are doing unfamiliar things with their bodies and unfamiliar things with their minds. Things that go against human nature. Things that go against men and women. Things that are incorrect in the body. They do this because they are trying to supplement for that lack. But it's not a supplement of more faith or more of this or more of that. It's comfort. It's comfort. We have a certain thing called comfort food. We want the food to fill in where we're in pain, if we're grieving, if we're sad, if we're lonely, if we're in distress, if we don't know what to do. We eat. And that's why we find a lot of people to be over the weight that their bones can hold. I don't judge anybody who's dealing with their weight, but there's a certain measure of weight for each person's bone mass. And when that's exceeded, it's a problem. But a lot of that comes from emotional eating. We eat because we either are like Peter, we don't know what else to do, or we are like the disciples. We haven't done the prep work in order to get the insight as to how things come about to be done. And so we get a lot of emotional eating. But how many know food is not going to supply all of our needs? We can like it, we can love it, we can break it and bless it, and that's what the word says. But it's not where our comfort is going to come from. That comfort that we seek can only come from Christ. And the man was like, listen, if you want to help my belief, make me comfortable, because my child is uncomfortable and I need for him to get what he needs so that he can be well. This is nuts. And so Jesus says to him, look, just believe. Just believe. Continue to believe. Jesus wasn't asking him to do anything outside of himself. He already believed. He was just wanting Jesus to know, listen, I believe, but do it for me. Anything that happens to me that's good. I know you did it, Jesus. Do it now. So initially, Jesus rebukes the spirit, right? And he begins to really toil. And Jesus is saying, how long has he been doing this? Oh, yeah, he's been doing this forever. Okay, so we're going to have to pull this spirit out. And not just pull it out. We're going to have to cast it. And we're going to tell that spirit not to come back. Because what is happening is, you're pulling at it. You're pulling at it, but the spirit keeps coming back. The spirit keeps coming back. So I need you to believe wholly, because guess what? When I take this spirit out, I'm going to cast it. And when I cast it, it's going to be projected in that direction. It's not coming back like this way. Not like you project something on a screen and the image comes back. But you never get that light back, right? You get the image coming towards you, but you never get that light. Why? Because the light is casted that way. So when you cast something, you cast it that way. It never comes back. But when the image of you changes, when it's transformed, you are always made whole. And that's what we're talking about, is that wholeness, embracing that wholeness. So I was taught that if you don't believe in Santa, you don't receive, right? That's my Santa story. So I just believed. And like I said at the beginning of the devotional, I just believed against belief. Like, even though I know y'all moving and shaking and getting things done in a hurry, and then, you know, Christmas morning, all this stuff appears, I just decided that Santa's like a spirit, because that's what I was told. And so that went on until about 13 or 14. And then my brother got sick. Very, very sick. And it was pretty grave at one point. And you get this sense as children, and I try to be mindful with this with my own children, that they're not going to tell me anything unless everything is good or something's really, really bad. So I started to get this sense that, well, no news is good news. So I'm not going to ask a lot of questions. And I didn't. In fact, I don't remember asking any questions about my brother being in the hospital. But what I do remember is Christmas was coming and I got worried, because I started to doubt, because the reality of how Santa moves in my house and gets Christmas done started to kind of get into my spirit, right? Well, if mom and dad are at the hospital, what does that say for the spirit of Santa? So my mother sat me down. She had a conversation with me and she said, listen, I need you to be Santa. I need you to be the spirit of Santa this year, because I can't go. I can't do it. And I just need you to make it nice for your brother and sister. And so I had to go with my daddy. I remember thinking, okay, this is not good. I don't know what I'm doing. He definitely don't know what he's doing. And I have to believe, because my brother and my sister believe. So I'm trying to channel the spirit of Santa, you know. And I can remember getting myself things and wrapping the gifts, and we opened them together. And there it was, Santa, right there in the middle of the hospital room with my brother. And I remember getting some pearls. And I remember a green bodysuit. And I don't know why, but that's the only thing I can remember at that time. I don't know that I even shared it with my friends or that they even ever knew that my brother was in the hospital. All I knew was that things were different. But I also knew that things would be well. And I remember my belief in Santa changing. I became sober about the realities of who Santa Claus was. But then something hit me. But my brother was made well. He was made whole. So the spirit of Santa still exists because there's this whole boy. And he was made well. And so I got what I wanted. I got exactly what I wanted. And I wasn't there to make it happen. God did it in the hospital room. I wasn't there when the wellness happened, but it happened while I was doing Santa's job, or at least I thought. God was giving me a gift through the same spirit of giving, and my brother was made well. And so I think about that often when I think about my belief, that when you believe, God is working something in your belief that you can't even imagine. You don't even know what you're asking for. You don't even know how to pray. You don't even know what you need. You're worried about being Santa when God is trying to provide you something in the midst of it that you really need, that you want, where your heart is. Your heart's not into those things. You need it to make a moment for people that you care about. But in the end, it is God who gave the increase of wellness. It is God that heals. It is God that delivers. It is God that brings that peace. And so there we were. I was the new Santa. And my brother was well. And next year, everything went back to normal. And when I came downstairs, everything was there. And so, I remember, you know, my mom getting ready to set some things out when I was in college, maybe grad school, and the night before Christmas. And me and my brother and sister were like, "What you doing?" And she was like, "I'm just putting some stuff under the tree." I mean, we're all pretty much adults here now. We're like, things don't go under the tree until Santa comes. And so she was like, "Okay, you know." But that's what happens when you plant a seed in your children. They believe against belief, against unbelief. So anyway, that's my story. But it also made me think of one of my favorite movies, The Goonies. I don't know if you remember The Goonies from the 80s, but they were like this troop, right? This team of young boys. And there was something happening at the time. Their parents were losing jobs, and one particular family was going to lose everything. And so they get into this whole adventure of trying to get One-Eyed Willie's treasure. And so they have to combat, you know, these people who are also looking for the treasure that are not good. And then these vices from the school, local school kids that are just mean and hateful and bullying. And they get to this well, and in the well, of course, it's all these coins. Well, they think, oh my God, this is the treasure. But the truth is, it wasn't the treasure. The truth is that it was everybody's wishes who had come to the wishing well. Well, one of the girls in the story, she says, wait. These, we can't take these because these are people's wishes. So one of the boys, he looks at her and he said, "Listen, you see this wish? This one right here. This was my wish, and I didn't get it. So guess what? I'm taking everything in here because I deserved this, and I didn't get it." And so the girls look at him, they look at each other, and they say, "Okay, there's nothing else to say." And some of us get jaded like that, right? We get jaded by being believers. Like, I've been believing my whole life for a man. Where is he? Where is he, Jesus? I prayed, I fasted, I trusted. Where is he? I believed God for my mother's healing, and she died. I believed God for that thing for my child, and it didn't come to pass. They never improved their grades. I wanted something. I believed you. It was a good thing. Why didn't I get it? And we get jaded. We get jaded, not thinking that the testing of our faith is producing patience. So, was it the treasure? No. He then digs deep. He goes to the bottom because he's looking for the good stuff. And then that's when the bullies arrive at the top of the well. And they bring perspective to everything because their meanness, their unkindness. The kids say, you know what? We don't even want to go up the well. We're just going to keep going towards the treasure that was intended for us because there's nothing good at the top of that well for us. And so they move on. And eventually they get to the treasure that God has for them. They get to the treasure that they believed on the map that was going to save all of them, give their families an opportunity to stay so that they can continue to be friends and go to school with each other. It's a very inspiring story. It's amazing how we settle for certain things. And then when we don't get them, we're mad. We settle. We don't get it. Then we're mad. We never think about the path to the real treasure. We never think about the opportunities that believing has for us. That pulling out something that should not be there can only be done through fasting and prayer, through supplication, through believing and keeping our faith out until it accomplishes what it is set out to accomplish. So this is believing. So what does it really take to believe? What does it really, really take for us to believe as believers? And when we share our faith, what does it really take? What are we really telling people that it's going to take to really get to the bottom line? I'd like to suggest three things. Number one, it takes time. James 1:4 says, "But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing." I like that it says her. It uses the female form. And when I've read that in the past, I've always thought, man, patience is like a girl. Patience is like a woman. You know how much patience it takes to let something move around in your body for 9 months and pray and hope you can get it on the other side. And then you got to raise it. When I say it, I mean a baby like them. So, yeah, I consider patience to be a woman because the virtue that comes out of your body when you have children, it has to produce. The patience has to produce. And I think that that's what we miss is that, you know, the patience has to produce. It does. The patience has to produce. In the midst of it is perfecting you, right? It's perfecting you. And when it's perfecting you, it makes you a perfected work for the production. Faith is perfecting us for what God has produced for us. So I think about greens during this time, right? People who cook greens just put a pot on, right? They don't really cook them. They just put it on. Well, my grandmother's greens are the best in the world. I just fundamentally believe that. And I'm sure you think your grandmother's greens were the best, and to God be the glory. But I just believe that my grandmother's greens are the best. And I remember one Christmas I had come home. And I think my parents were not able to come up. I'm not really sure, but I was in Kentucky and I had been staying with my grandmother for the holiday. And I remember smelling those greens all day long. Oh my God, how many more hours to the greens are going to be done? I have been patient. I have been kind. I didn't get no slither out of the pot. What is happening? So, two of my aunts come in, my youngest two aunts, and immediately they go over to the pot. And I said, "Oh God, don't those greens smell good?" They said, "Yeah, they smell good." I go out of the room, I come back, they are sitting at the table, red hot sauce and greens. I'm looking at them. I said, what are y'all doing with the greens? I don't understand. I've been in here smelling greens all day and I haven't eaten any. And they looked at me and they said, yeah, we feel so sorry for you that you made that decision. And sometimes faith takes time, right? Believing takes time. And then sometimes we believe and then we miss it. We miss it. The moral of the story is we can be patient in believing, but don't miss it. Don't mistake angels by ignoring strangers. Don't not see the angel in a situation because that person is a stranger. Don't let that smell sit in your nostrils and somebody get in front of you before they get to the pot. That bowl was rightfully mine. But you know what the difference between myself and them? Patience had already been produced in the house before they got there. They knew when the gift was ready. I didn't. And sometimes life is like that. Sometimes people just know. They say, it's time. You've been training. You've been believing God. You have been patient. It's time to eat at the table. And they just did it. And I just stood there and watched them. I said, oh, okay. I guess I'll get me a bowl. I said, I cannot believe that you all beat me to that pot. And they said, I don't know what to tell you. You should have, I don't know what made you think these greens weren't done. Why? Because they were still on. So not only in that time that it takes, are you developing perfection and patience, but you got to know when to move. Okay? Because there's a time for everything. Everything has a beginning and an ending in this time cycle. And if we don't take advantage of it, we'll miss it. So suffice it to say, I went and got my greens and my red hot. So things take time. That's number one when it comes to believing. But also things take thought. They take thought. Philippians, the 4th chapter, verses 6-9 says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. So, not only do things take time, they take thought. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and petition, make your request be made known unto God. With thanksgiving, and the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. So in thinking and taking thought, we are able to consider those things that are good, those things that are just, those things that are admirable. And when we meditate on those things, we become perfect and lacking nothing. Okay? And so meditation on the right thing will change a heart. The thought process that we take in believing is going to be what that end result looks like. Don't expect to get something different in the end result when your believing is not right, because right believing equals right living. So I had a kid, a student, and we'll just call him Eminem. Eminem was a hot mess. I pray for him all the time. Sweetest, cutest little white boy, blue eyes. I just loved him to death. And he was interesting. Maybe his eyes were green. I can't remember. But they were beautiful. I just wanted to get to his heart. I believed that I could reach him. And so I put myself in hazard's way many, many times, danger's way. And so there was this one instance where he had just gotten tired of me. Like, stop telling me you're going to be here for me. I'm in foster care. You know, you don't know what it's like to not have parents, all of this, that, and the third. Excuse me. And I'm looking at him and I'm like, listen, cry me a river. We all got issues. I literally said that to this kid in foster care. And I said, what is important is today. I am here with you and you are here with me. I believe in you. I believe that you can make a better choice. The whole time he's telling me, listen, Ms. White, get out of my way. Because if you don't, I'm going to knock you out. Now, he's like this tall, probably 68 pounds soaking wet. I'm looking at him. I said, you going to knock me out? I said, well, go right ahead. Give it your best shot. So then he sees the assistant principal down the hall and he says, he says, hey, Mr. G, I told Miss White, you better come get her because I'm a hitter. And when I do, she's going to be saying, I don't know what happened. And I just bust out laughing. He doing the swirly like on the cartoons. Excuse me. And I just laughed. I mean, I just laughed uncontrollably. I could not stop laughing. But I ended up getting to his heart. And at one point, he stopped that madness. And eventually, he asked me to be his mom. He said, you know, Miss White, you a good lady. And I think you could be my mom. And I would be a good brother to your daughters. And I promise to always be good. And I said, baby, I know that you're good. You don't have to tell me. And so, as the story would go, he brought me a present. And it was these colors. And it's like he knew what I liked. He said, I got something for you, Miss White. He just wanted me to have his heart. He just wanted me to have his heart. And I believed that I could get to him. But it took time. It took patience. It took thought. It wasn't something that I just woke up with. Because anything worth having is worth believing for. It was an excellent thing to see. I believed I was good and not restraining in his life. But I had to show him I'd risk getting hit. Consistently thinking about how to reach his heart changed my heart. How often do we want a thing to change, but we haven't done the hard work inside to believe against all belief for the change? So we have to take time, right? Believing takes time. Believing takes thought. We have to take thought. The last thing is it takes trust. Believing takes trust. So let's talk a little bit about trust and then we're out. Proverbs, the third chapter, verses 5-6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he shall direct your paths. In the Message Bible, it says, trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on track. So trusting from the bottom of your heart requires getting to the very crevices of the spirit that may be hindering the trust. It means dealing with those things that lack discipline. Athletes get it. They trust in their abilities. Why? Because they have developed the discipline of the sport they play. They practice to make permanent, not to make perfect. So when they get on the soccer field or the golf course or the tennis court, they automatically trust because the discipline is built in the body. Likewise, we should trust God in our daily walk and the permanent embrace we feel when he holds us in this life. Faith brings about that feeling. My daily walks have taught me this, the discipline of walking 2 times a day is trusting God. It's not just trusting God. It's trusting that I will hear from him, even when life is hectic and I can't collect my thoughts. The trust has come about as a result of the muscle I have developed. But the desire to develop the muscle came from God, which was a pre-trust moment, right? So you trust God, but then there's this pre-trust moment that I'm going to trust you, that you're going to give me what I need to trust you. But the desire to develop the muscle came from God, which was the pre-trust moment, to trust him for the walk. The walks helped me trust him. I trust him to get a word when I'm on my walk. Then life becomes a cycle of trust, and trust builds trust. And it starts from the seeds of trust we have for our parents or guardians. And out of that trust comes trust in others, and ultimately trust in God. So on this Christmas Eve, let's check our believer radar. Let's trace back to the beginning of our lives when we only believed like little children in Santa, in our parents, in the teacher to learn, in God to deliver, to affirm, and to confirm. The spirit of believing never goes away. It may lie dormant, but it is always present. And I always saw myself as a Christian athlete. I remember when I first started working out, I was probably about 21, 22. I always walked, but I never really got on a treadmill or did any real work. The moment I dropped a bead of sweat, I was out of there. But in later in life, I decided to start walking on a regular basis. And what I've realized now that the muscle in my body has become the muscle in my heart and in my mind. That muscle has gotten me to this place where I believe. It was always there, but it was lying dormant. So I encourage you today. The believer never goes away. It never goes away. So if you have lost heart in this holiday season, if the pandemic has scorned you, it's made you jaded, and you just want to take everything you see and put it in your pocket. Whatever I can grab, that's going to be my riches. I encourage you to try God one more time. Try him today. Trust him with your finances. Trust him with your children. Trust him with your home. Trust him with your job. Trust him with your calling. Believe only. Accept his wholeness. And see if that trust doesn't build another trust. And this trust builds this trust. And this trust builds that trust. And in the end, you become a trusting individual, and patience in the process helps you focus and believe God only. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the trust that you put in our heart. We thank you for the time and the thought that it takes to get to that belief. We believe you only. We know that all good and perfect gifts come from the Father of lights, in whom there's no variation. But we can be varying. We look at ourselves in the mirror and we leave and we forget what our reflection looks like. But when we trust in you, you remind us. You remind our withering minds and our fleeting thoughts about how good you made us. That your creation is good. And not because of us, but because of you. That you did it. That you are calling us out of ourselves to do what you've called us to do. So as we celebrate the birth of Christ, as we look forward to all the many blessings that this Christmas holiday is going to bring, we just pray for peace. Everybody didn't have money. Everybody didn't have things. Some people are separated from their parents physically, some by choice, some not by choice. So we pray for the Comforter to come into the hearts of the children, that they'd be able to get something that they need, that they want, if they don't have their parents. Likewise, for those who have lost their parents, who are adults, God, comfort their heart on today. Lord, bring them a peace. Even some of us who have maybe not lost people, but we've lost things. We've lost jobs. We've lost hope. We're not looking for you to fill our lack. We're looking for you to comfort us. Show us your will. Your word says it will not come back void. So we cast the word of progress. We cast the word of vision. We cast the word of mission. We cast the word of our goals and our beliefs, bringing about what you said they would. And we believe you for it. Now that we have put our faith on the line, we will not pull it back until it accomplishes what it's set to accomplish. And we'll be careful to honor you and praise you. We love you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So go with God today. Enjoy your day. It's 7:54 Eastern Standard Time, which is going to give you plenty of time to finish whatever you need to do in this day. Remember that God is for you. Jesus is with you. The Holy Spirit is in you, and all of heaven's angels are on your side. God bless you. Happy Christmas Eve. Bye.